Greetings and various assorted salutations, and welcome to the Indus River Valley Civilizations introductory lecture. As always, we go over the basics about this civilization so that in the ancient civilizations class we can dive into more detail over special topics. So, once again, it's what it is and its significance. So, let's get started with the modern day and pop culture references. In the West, so the United States, for the most part, there isn't a lot of pop culture references to the Indus River Valley civilization. We're going to get into some reasons about that, but it's simply one of the big limiting factors is there's just not a lot of information about them, and a lot of archaeological work is ongoing on these sites. It's in modern-day Pakistan, and it's considered kind of the foundational civilization for the Pakistanis, and especially for the peoples of India. It's seen kind of as the starting point for Hinduism. So perhaps more pop culture references are going to be found in places like India and Pakistan as opposed to in the United States. There's just not that same connection. Because there's just not as much research done yet, and some other factors that we'll get into. So, that didn't take long. Let's go into the basics. The Indus River Valley people are a heavily urbanized civilization that's found in the Indus River Valley and along the northern India's, modern-day northern India's coast. It's not as heavily studied of region as Mesopotamia, but they are contemporary. Essentially, they existed at the around the exact same time as the Mesopotamians. And so, and we have archaeological evidence to show that Mesopotamia and the Indus River Valley, they were in contact with each other in trading. So those extensive trade networks with Mesopotamia, it wasn't just within the city-states of Sumer. Eventually, those connections bridge out all the way into, well, northern India. As for the where, the most current, mostly in current-day Pakistan, that's where the Indus River Valley is. It's basically kind of almost a heartland for Pakistan. And some of the civilizations are in northern India. But you can see that most of the cities are located along the Indus River Valley. Harappa, I probably mispronounced it, is one of the major cities, and this city as well. I guess I'm looking at the pronunciation now. This is Harappa, and the other one is Mohenjo-daro. So very phonetic pronunciations at this point. Were these cities what they were actually called when they were occupied by the ancient peoples? Not likely, but we'll get to that in a second. But this is where the Indus River Valley civilization, at its largest, occupied these areas. You can see there's a few other smaller settlements. You'll notice that they're almost always by rivers, and that's because when you're talking about agriculture especially, though pretty much all civilizations follow this trend, is where's the water? You need easy access to water. Some more complex civilizations can move water where they need it, but building right next to a river is often the most common action because it's the easiest way. If water just naturally flows to you, you're set. Now, this is a Bronze Age civilization. They traded with Mesopotamia. I already told you that. The archaeologists are starting to see people in this area, not necessarily farming. Farming seems to come a few thousand years later. And in 2600 BC, that's when the cities appear to be at their peak. And then around 1900 BC, they're gone. The civilizations, the cities appear to be largely abandoned at this time. Historically, this has been blamed on the nomadic people, the Aryans. However, there's more evidence now that we're better at studying soil and historical soil, like digging down and archaeological theory, we have a pretty good idea that around this time period, around 1900 BC, we have what appears to be some droughts and erosion. And that usually is what does finish off civilizations. External threats are always a problem, but usually, especially with nomads aren't necessarily known for come in and annihilate everyone. If you want to talk about like the Mongols, for instance, or groups that came in and took over the Mesopotamians, they would come in and they would install the leadership. They'd take out like the top tier of the leadership, but they'd leave most of the civilization intact, especially the bureaucracy, because they wanted to reap the benefits of the civilization, but they didn't have the know-how. Organizing cities and city-states and empires takes a lot of organization, and there's certain people that already have that skill set, and they're usually not the ones in the highest positions of power. They're usually the bureaucrats and the ones who, the tax collectors, those people. And so often those people remain in place. But when you have a drought and erosion, there's not a good reason to stick around in a city, because that's just you're surrounded by more people who are going hungry, and that's usually when a civilization falls apart, is when food and water become too scarce for people to really have a reason to stick around. Going into the how, we do know from the archaeological evidence that they were very organized. They had very good farming systems. They had a very high quality of standard living. Archaeology evidence suggests that they had sewer systems and running water in many households that we can find. The two big cities I mentioned before, the one here and the one further upriver up here, these two, they're the most heavily studied, and they are built to a level of urban planning that you knew that they had to be highly organized. They're just way too organized to not have that, and it's shown in the archaeological evidence. The houses are built a certain way, the roads, the sewers, the running water systems, they can study all that. However, beyond that, we can't really tell you much about their governments. Their cities may or may not have been united. We can't really tell if there's any records of warfare being a big problem in this area during this time, but we just don't have a lot of pieces. But we do know that they're very good at farming, and their cities were really nice. Probably nicer than some pre-industrial cities in later eras, especially with the sewer and the running water systems. Let's talk about some of their notable accomplishments. Here's a picture of one of their waterways. I don't know which one it is, but it's one of them. We know that they have extensive trade networks because they seem to have contact with Mesopotamians, because we find Mesopotamian stuff in Indus River Valley cities, and we find Indus River Valley city products in Mesopotamian cities. And so the trade networks were very well maintained, and given how much archaeological evidence is left behind, trade was extensive. I've already mentioned the grand cities. We theorize that these two cities in particular could support massive populations for this time period. Even in some parts of America, that's larger than a lot of cities. The other interesting thing from the archaeological evidence is that these two cities appear to be almost exact copies of each other. And that just shows you the very high level of organization they must have had. Because often when you're building stuff, especially if you're in many eras, you couldn't build exact replicas. Or the architects in charge, they would change things or they'd do things differently. But between these two cities, the similarity of how they're laid out indicates that they had like architectural standards and very complex systems of math and calculation to lay out exact copies, and they're not close together. They're effectively, scrolling back up to this map again, they're effectively on opposite ends of the area. So there's a lot of organization there. We also know that they have a writing system, and this is why I kept saying we just don't know this, we don't know that. It's because they have a complex writing system, but we can't read it at all. We know that we can see that there's writing systems on their pottery. They wrote on copper tablets. They have stamps. They have weights. They have amulets. I'll scroll back up to show you. They've got these. We know that's an elephant. We know that's different animals here. I think that's a rhino. It looks like a rhino. But we cannot read any of this. We don't know what it says. Then that's not for lack of trying. But one of the challenges, and we'll look at it more this week in class, but one of the limiting factors we run into is if we can't read the language, we depend on archaeology. And archaeology can tell us a lot. It tells us they were organized. It tells us they had great sewage and running water systems. It tells us how prosperous they were. But without being able to read the writing, we don't know their stories. We don't know their government. We don't know... We don't know the different roles they had in society. We don't know their myths and legends. We just don't have a lot of access to things. And so a lot of the Indus River Valley past is locked away in unreadable documents. And what we'll look at more this week is we'll look at how we can read cuneiform, the Mesopotamian language, but how we can't read the Indus River Valley civilization's language. But we're working on it. There's some experts in India, the ones we'll look at least, but there's some experts in India who are really cracking away at it. They're throwing down some state-of-the-art computer technology to try and see if can we brute force figure out what they're saying based on what they've left behind. Because it's not an easy process. Anyways, that concludes the feature presentation. What we'll look at more in the class is we'll look at some special topics, go into archaeology, a lot of archaeology stuff, so if you're into that, you're set. We're going to look at the language. While we can't read the Indus River Valley Civilization language, we're going to look at how different cultures' languages work and try and figure them out. But there is no built Minecraft build video for this week. I just don't have a lot of resources to look at what the Indus River Valley people did, but I will be working on some of the other ones, like Egypt. So, no build video this week, but I'll probably release something else that might catch your interest. But, until later.